the program, there was supposed to be grade 1 and grade 2 from a D1T, but unfortunately he had an accident. And it's not a big accident, I think. But luckily also, we have a replacement, which is Professor Antonio Acín, right?
Mm-hmm.
From ICFO, which is a big institute of quantum information theory.
Well, it's about light, let's say.
Okay, light in general.
So there is quantum light, quantum physics, but there is also light.
And you'll be talking about quantum random number generators?
Yes,
yeah?
Yes.
So
okay. Well, thank you for the introduction. And I'm, of course, very sorry for my late arrival. I'm a bit, sometimes I'm a bit unpredictable when it comes to being on time. And the fact is that originally this talk was, or this lecture was supposed to be given by Grégoire Bordy, who is the CEO of Idecantique. So Idecantique is a company based in Switzerland that they sell products based on quantum physics, information products based on quantum physics. And he couldn't make it, so I'm here. And so Grégoire is a CEO of a company, and I'm a theoretical physicist. So as you can imagine, our talks are going to be a bit different. I got some of his slides. I'll try my best to decipher what he meant in the slides, but I cannot give his talk because it's impossible. He's a businessman, I'm a researcher, okay? Although he has a PhD and we even have some articles together, but the talk is going to be a bit different. But I understand that one of the objectives of this lecture is that know about how you can use quantum physics to generate randomness, and this is what my talk is going to be about, but probably I will focus more on, say, fundamental aspects, and he may have focused more on technological aspects. But I think, okay, I mean, you can ask questions. I think there is someone from Idecantique here that maybe he's able to answer some of the technical questions, if there is any. But in my case, I'm going to focus more on, say, theoretical questions, okay? Okay, good. So maybe I should start by asking, who knows about quantum physics here? Okay, not so many. Okay, good. So I won't assume any knowledge of quantum physics during my talk. But I guess even if you have never worked with quantum physics, you know that quantum physics is a physical theory that was invented at the end of 19th century, mostly first half of the 20th century, to describe basically what happens at this level. Okay, what happens when you have to deal with atoms and also when you have to deal with light at a very attenuated level, at the level of single photons. And then there are some effects, already at the end of the 19th century, there were some experiments that for which, say, Newtonian physics, which was the theory that was able to describe what happens at this scale, was unable to give an explanation. Okay, and this is why then people had to invent a new theory, and this is why quantum physics came. Okay, and then with quantum physics, we can explain what happens here. And also, we understand that classical physics is just somehow an effective theory that is covered by quantum physics. That classical physics is a good theory in this region, but fails to be good when you are dealing with atoms or photons. Okay, photons meaning the single excitation of light. Okay, so what happened at the end of the 19th century is that somehow physicists made the transition. Okay, so they went from our macroscopic classical, I would call it classical scale. Okay, so the classical scale is the scale where classical physics can be applied. Okay, so even if we have quantum physics, we don't need quantum physics to make airplanes or cars. Okay, we are still using classical physics because it's a theory that explains, predicts well what is happening at this scale. Okay, so physics made this transition, say, at the end of the 19th century, beginning of the first half of the 20th century. Physicists went from the macroscopic scale to microscopic scale, and then they invented quantum physics. So somehow, the same is happening now for information theory. Okay, so now people are wondering what happens when we encode information on this particle, say atoms or photons. Okay, I put in single excitation of light. And then we want to, and usually our information applications are at this scale. Okay, so okay, even if things are miniaturized, we never reach the level where quantum effects become important at the moment. Okay, but we are now reaching the point where we have to deal with quantum effects. So people started wondering, okay, what will happen when we reach this point? And perhaps the first message I want to give you is that, as you may know, quantum information theory then cares about what is happening. And There are some results proving that you may have better, more powerful computers. This is a quantum computer that you may have heard of. And there is a new form of cryptography, of secure cryptography. I will spend some more time here for secure cryptography. And then people are caring about how to make these theoretical ideas practical, and there are some investments, and now quite recently it has been approved a big investment on quantum technologies to make some of these things happen. Okay, this we'll see what remains after quantum information theory. But as a theory, something that I learned with quantum information theory is that it's a change of paradigm in the way we understand information. So before quantum information theory, I'm a physicist, but I also have a degree in telecommunication engineer. If you had asked me whether a change on physical in the physical laws that we use to describe information implies a change on the ways, on the applications we can do with this information, if you had asked me this question, I mean, some years ago, I would have said, well, it doesn't imply any change, because one of the nice things of information theory is that it has nothing to do with physics. Okay, this is why information theory, I mean, I can send you a bit just with these two things. Okay, I can send you a zero and a one. From an information point of view, there is no difference. I mean, information theory somehow seems to be independent from physics. I mean, of course, when money and practicalities matter, you better do a bit not with this marker and this remote control. But from an information theory point of view, this is just a perfect bit, as good as the bits we use for information transmission. Okay, so this is why I think people thought that, and I also thought that, I mean, that information has nothing to do with physics, and then if we make this transition from classical physics to quantum physics, nothing will change. But what quantum information theory tells us is this is not the case. Okay, so when you do this transition, since you encode information on some particles and you use some devices, and these devices are described by different physical laws, you can do things that are possible with these devices that are not possible with our current devices described by classical physics. Okay. So I think there is a change of paradigm in which now physics matters. And we have new rules because we have new devices and we have new physical laws. Okay? Again, I don't know whether we will have a quantum computer in the future, but I think that the way we understand information has changed because of quantum information theory, at least for me. And my talk is going to be about, okay, what is quantum information theory? You try to understand what happens, how you can use quantum effects to do things that are relevant for information processing. And in my case, I was asked to give a talk about what happens when you use quantum effects to generate randomness. So I'm going to tell you about quantum random number generators. But again, this is a part of a bigger field, which is quantum information theory, where you try to understand what happens when you use quantum physics to do something relevant for information theory. Okay, so I will start by trying from scratch, let's say, and I will try to define randomness. Okay, I'm not an information theorist, so I hope you don't mind if I try to do this in this, say, audience. So I will try to define randomness, say, from a sort of perhaps more physical approach. Okay, so what I want to do in my talk is there is a user that has a device. So usually any random generator is a device that produces bits, okay, symbols. So there is this user has this device. This device may have some quantum particles inside. I don't really care. You can see it just as a black box. And this black box gives bits. Okay? So what we want to certify somehow, the user wants to certify that these bits are random. Okay? This is common to everyone. I don't think anyone has any complaint about this. You tell me if you have. Of course, you can interrupt me anytime. Okay, so this is my definition. So if you are not happy, please complain. So I would say that bits produced by this device, and bits, say, are random if they are unpredictable. And what I will ask is that they are not only, so they were unpredictable. Of course, when they are generated, they are not unpredictable anymore. So they are unpredictable not only to the user, but to any possible user that may exist that is possibly sharing a device that is correlated to this device. Okay? So I ask unpredictability not to the person who is running the device, but even to other person that might be there and may have a device correlated to the device that is used to generate the bits. Okay? So this is my definition. And I will tell you why I like this definition. Well, I think I'm a theoretical physicist, so I care somehow about fundamental physics. So from this fundamental physics point of view, I like this definition because to me it's very difficult to argue that this process is random if there is someone who can predict these outputs. Okay, so I think it makes perfect sense from a fundamental point of view to say that this is random, and no one can predict this output. Okay, so this is why I demand unpredictability to any observer. And now from a practical perspective, the nice thing is that if I want, for instance, to use these random numbers for cryptography, which I think is one of the main themes in this conference, well, if I somehow I can certify that these numbers are unpredictable, if I use them in my location and I assume that my location is secure, then this randomness will be private and useful for cryptographic applications. Because my possible enemy, Eve, who is outside me, who can be a possible observer, cannot predict this output, and then I can use them because they are effectively random. Okay, so this is why, with this definition, I have that my definition of randomness guarantees that these symbols are private to anyone else but me. Okay, so, well, you see, I'm a theorist, so I will start by this. So if you take this definition of randomness, what you can prove is that to certify that something is random is impossible, only with this definition, okay, from scratch. Well, because, I mean, if you think more, even from a philosophical point of view, you can never falsify, an hypothesis in which you say that everything has been written in advance and someone has a description of all what is going to happen. Okay, I'm being super fundamental in this sense, okay? But in principle, there can be a theory, even the Big Bang, where someone has written all what is going to happen, including what I'm saying now. Okay, so if I want to prove randomness, I have to make some assumptions. It's a triviality, maybe, what I'm saying, okay? But I need assumptions. Okay, so any protocol for randomness generation must be based on assumptions. Again, I think it's trivial, but let's start with something that I guess we all agree on. Okay, so I didn't attend the school, I'm sorry for that, but I guess many of the people talked about assumptions for randomness that are based on what I called computational security. And I think many applications in classical cryptography are based on computational security. So basically what you do, that the possible eavesdropper, this possible observer that is outside your lab, has a bounded computational power. For me, this is a perfectly valid assumption. Okay, and this is what defines, again, then in this approach of computational security, I can prove randomness because I assume that my enemy who wants to predict the stuff has a limited computational power. And because of this limited computational power, this person cannot predict the output that are going to be generated by my device. Again, please correct me because I'm trying to say things to people who know more than me about this, okay? But this is my understanding of computational security, okay? So you make an assumption, whoever is there has a bounded computational power. Okay, sometimes you have to be careful with this because if you think about it, this is not the assumption that you use to prove that something, to certify that something is random, okay? Because basically, for instance, if you think about cryptography, there is a very famous protocol that is called RSA, okay, this is not randomness, but it's based on factoring. But there is no proof that factoring is hard, okay? This is, again, a belief. So actually, they are not the assumption is not that the eavesdropper computational power is limited, but the assumption is, I believe that the problem is hard. And this is based on the fact that many deep thinkers tried to solve this problem for decades, and they failed. Again, for me, this is a valid assumption. Based on this assumption, you prove that something is secure or random. Okay, me as a quantum information theorist, I will tell you that some of these protocols, some of these problems that were believed to be hard are easy for a quantum computer, but then you can say, okay, my assumption is that there are no quantum computers today. Fine, then your stuff is secure, it's random. So there's always a level of assumptions, okay? And a good thing about computational security is that it's cheap, because mostly you use software. I'm not going to tell you about computational security, I'm going to tell you about physical security, okay? This is where a guy like me, okay, comes here to tell you things, okay? Otherwise, this would have never happened before. So in quantum cryptography, most of the protocols, and basically all quantum random number generation protocols that I'm aware of, are based on physical security, okay? So the assumption, you don't make any assumption about whether your enemy has computational bounded computational power. What you assume is that the devices, including the devices by your enemy, have to satisfy some physical laws, in this case, quantum physics. So whatever your enemy does, this enemy cannot break the laws of quantum physics. Again, this is an assumption. I can believe that some computer scientists are more happy with computational assumptions than physical assumptions. Me as a physicist, I'm happier with assuming that quantum physics is correct. But again, it's a matter of taste. You can choose whatever you want. Me, already many years ago, I chose physical security because I'm a physicist. But if you don't like it and you like computational security, this is your decision. So the reason why I like it is because you don't have to make any assumption on the interoperable power, but you only assume that her actions, okay, don't contradict quantum physics. And then, based on this assumption, you can prove that the scheme is secure under these assumptions. But of course, one thing that happens is that the implementation of this scheme is often more demanding because you have to deal with quantum particles. These are atoms. Atoms are very fragile, so it's more expensive. Okay, so my talk is going to be about physical security, random number generations, based on the assumption that quantum mechanics is correct. Okay, so when I said before that I want that some numbers are random because they cannot be predicted by any observer, now I can make this a bit more precise. So what I demand is that these are not, the random numbers should be unpredictable to any physical observer. Okay, so any physical observer whose actions are constrained by the laws of quantum physics. And this is how I want to prove or certify or, yes, that something is random. And, I like very much this joke because I think it represents some of what you are, maybe you have seen this joke before, okay? So this is what we all want to do. Maybe here we are fighting for the same, no? So there is this Dilbert, there's a famous cartoon, and she's the random number generator, and of course, he wonders whether this is random. Okay, this is what we like to do, okay? You can think of my previous plot as this is the user and this is the device that produces random numbers, and this guy wants to make sure that this is random. Okay, so we want to certify whether anything like this is possible, either by computational assumptions or by physical assumptions. Okay, good. So, my talk is going to be about physics, okay? I will use no equations. I think I will use concepts that you are familiar with because you have a scientific education, I guess, and very little of quantum physics. So if we think even fundamentally about whether randomness exists in classical physics, okay? So let's try to use physics. Is there any place where we can get randomness in classical physics? Well, the answer is no, okay? Fundamentally, it's not. I'm not saying about practical randomness. Okay? I understand that if you monitor, I don't know, the movements of a mouse, of a user, or temperature fluctuations on a given day, this might be quite unpredictable. But from a fundamental perspective, these things are not random. Okay? Why? Well, because all the randomness there comes from a lack of knowledge. Okay? You don't have a good description of what I'm going to do, what the temperature is going to be tomorrow. Okay? So, well, this is, no, there's the typical example of the roulette. You cannot predict, but if you improve your knowledge about the speed and position of your ball, and you have a good model about the roulette, well, the randomness is decreased. Ideally, you can decrease it up to level zero. You have an ideal description of your initial position and speed of the ball, okay? So in this sense, from a fundamental perspective, there is nothing like pure or intrinsic randomness in classical physics, because if you give me the initial description of my particles, initial positions and velocities, you take the Newton laws, you solve Newton laws, and you can compute everything. It might be demanding, but remember, I don't want to make any assumption about computational power. Okay, so in this sense, I mean, from a fundamental point of view, randomness, if you want to use classical devices, is just a consequence of ignorance. Okay, because your knowledge about your initial conditions are not perfect, and this is why you cannot predict what is going to happen. So this has some problems sometimes, because you may believe that something is random because you have a knowledge about some conditions, but your enemy might have maybe not perfect knowledge, but may have better knowledge about these initial conditions. And you think that something is completely random, but this enemy has a better knowledge about these initial conditions, and something that looks random to you is not fully random to your enemy, simply because maybe the enemy has a better model to predict meteorology tomorrow, weather forecast. Let's say you use weather forecast. Maybe your enemy has a better model to predict the weather forecast, and then he can make a better model and a better prediction for the things that you consider that are random. Again, if you want to use them, it's fine. I'm just saying things that happen, okay, from this point of view. And there is a famous quote by Laplace, who was one of the fathers of superdeterminism, that tells you that if you know everything at the initial moment, you can predict the future with certainty. Oh, no, no, this seems philosophy. I mean, then later I will tell you more scientific things, okay? Okay, so if you stick to this paradigm of physical security and you want to prove things based on physical laws, we know that classical physics is not the place to go. again, you can do practical things, but if you want like some sort of randomness in nature, classical physics is not the way to go. So let's go to the quantum regime. Okay, so these are the slides by Grégoire, but before going to the quantum regime, then I will tell you a bit of things about quantum physics, because I've seen that some of you know about quantum physics. Now I will use the whiteboard. So if I can get some light here. Okay, so why is quantum physics random as opposed to classical physics? So what I was telling you is that in classical physics, when you look at the theory, there is nothing like randomness in the theory, okay? So the theory tells you, fix the initial conditions, solve these equations of motion, and you will find the solution in a deterministic way, okay? Probability comes from ignorance, but in the theory as such, I mean, if you open a textbook on classical physics, there is nothing like randomness. In quantum physics, you open a textbook in quantum physics, and already in the first equation or second, already the randomness appears. Okay, so why is it so? You go to, say, any textbook in quantum physics, and many textbooks in quantum physics start with a list of postulates. Okay, so they tell you how the theory is constructed. Again, these are postulates. You assume the validity of these postulates because these postulates are satisfied in every experimental lab. Okay, it could be that one day they will be proven to be wrong, but today they describe how nature behaves. Okay, so what this quantum physics describes is a system. Okay, and what quantum physics tells you is that you have a physical system. Associated to this physical system, there is a Hilbert space. Why? We don't know. But quantum physics tells you that you associate to every physical system, you associate a Hilbert space. And it's a Hilbert space. For simplicity, I will take in a finite dimensional space. And it's a Hilbert space, a complex Hilbert space. Okay, so this is physics. And what the theory tells you is that to any physical system, you associate a Hilbert space, which is a complex Hilbert space of dimension d. Okay, so this is postulate one. To every physical system, quantum physics associates a Hilbert space. Good. I guess you all know about Hilbert spaces, right? So then the theory tells you that the state of this physical system is a vector in this Hilbert space. I don't know how you write vectors. Okay, it's just a vector. In quantum physics, you write it like this. Okay, but this is nothing but a vector in the Hilbert space. Okay, so in this case, what is a state of my system will be a vector. So the components, complex components that define a vector. This is a state of my system. Yeah, sorry. Well, it's nothing that the numbers, complex numbers. Okay, this is just a vector. So you have a system, and you want to describe with quantum physics. What you have to specify are, you know that your system has a given dimension. Say you have a spin 1/2 particle. It has two. You need two numbers. For some other system, you need more numbers. OK, you need a description of numbers. And these numbers are the component of this vector that lives in this Hilbert space. This is postulate number one of quantum physics. Now, the postulates also tell you the things you can do with these systems. So you can measure a quantum system. Okay? So there is this system here that can be a part, quantum particle, an atom. And you're going to measure a property of this system. And a measurement is just, I will write it like this in the box. No? So this particle, you send it into a measurement. And this measurement gives you several outputs. For simplicity, I will take the same number of outputs. Okay, so this is what happens in reality. Okay, you measure a property, and it tells you that the property is equal to 1, 2, 3, whatever. So postulate of quantum physics tells you a measurement is described by a basis in this Hilbert space. So you will have V1 up to Vd, linearly independent, actually, and orthonormal vectors. Okay, so these vectors again. Okay. Okay, the green one seems to work better. Okay, so I hope you understand what I'm saying here is that a measurement is given by a basis in this Hilbert space, super trivial algebra. Okay, so these are vectors that are orthogonal and normalized to one. Again, this is postulate number, I don't know, depends on the number, in 4 of quantum physics, okay? But this is, I mean, first pages of any textbook. Okay, now you say, okay, what happens when you have a system whose state is described by this vector in the Hilbert space, and you make a measurement, something that happens in many laboratories in the world, okay? So what are you going to observe here? So again, textbook in quantum physics tells you, okay, you're going to see that these outputs satisfy a probability law, and the probability of getting, okay, I will call the result R, the probability of getting result equal to I when you send the state V is equal to the VI tensor V square. Okay, this is what the theory tells you. So the probability of observing a given result here, say result I, okay, so here I had several results. The probability of observing one result here, I, when I send a system in state V, remember it's a vector, is equal to the overlap, okay, the scalar product between these two vectors squared. Again, you say, why? Well, this is what quantum physics tells you, and this is what describes seems to describe physics in the atomic scale. It's not that you like it or not, but this is what describes physics. Okay. So you see, already from the very beginning, the theory tells you that there is something probabilistic. There is nothing like this in classical physics. I mean, if you go to a textbook, nothing tells you the probability of observing this will be something. Okay. So quantum physics already from, say, at its postulate level, okay, from at postulates, already starts with some probabilities. So for instance, let me take the simplest example. You have the simplest quantum system, which is a system of dimension 2. This is something sometimes called a qubit, because it's like a bit, but a quantum bit. So what can be a state in this system? The vectors are normalized. This is a possible state of my system.
So the state is also normalized also?
State is normalized, yes, as well. Yeah, I forgot to say. Okay. So this is a possible state of my system. And now let's see what happens when I make a measurement. So a measurement, I need to define a basis. You see, this is a basis, right, for this Hilbert space of dimension 2. So what the theory tells you is that if you prepare a state of dimension 2 in this state, and you make this measurement on your particle, this sounds like algebra, but this is physics, OK? I can go to the lab and prepare this state and make this measurement. Then you will get result. Can you see this? Or? I'm sorry. Is it because it's too small? It's only the color.
Color.
Ah, I can see there. Okay. 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 I'm just here writing an example. Okay. You have the vector, which is 1/√2, 1/√2. This is normalized. Okay. This is a possible state of your system, and you make a measurement. And say a measurement is defined by a basis. So the basis vectors are 1, 0, and 0, 1. They are orthogonal. So what's the probability of getting result 1 is equal to 1√2, 1/√2, 1, 0, square, 1/2. Okay? So this is a perfect coin, let's say. Now,
what do you mean result 1? What is the, like, the outcome of the experiment?
Well, for instance, this, okay, can be a situation where you have, what is, I'm not using physics, but for instance, if you want to have a physical realization of that, you know that the atoms have a spin. It's called, this is a degree of freedom that atoms have, and actually spins, in most of the cases, is described by a Hilbert space of dimension 2. So this state I'm writing here, if you want a physical realization, is a spin pointing in the x direction. So a spin is, you can see it as an arrow that can be pointing in any direction, okay? So this corresponds to a spin pointing in the, say, x direction. So a spin can be any direction in R3. So this is spin pointing in the x direction. So you can now take a particle, and you align its spin along the x direction. And this measurement that I'm showing here is measuring the spin along the z-direction. So you put a magnetic field and you align along the z-direction. So you send the x particle, the spin x particle, to this apparatus. And you can see this. Maybe you have seen this. I don't know. Sometimes I saw this. So you send this particle with the spin in the x direction. And you apply this magnetic field in the b direction. And then you can see that the particle can go either here or here. And this happens with probability 1/2. Okay? So this is just the physical description of what I'm saying here. But again, as it happens with, say, information theory, I can give you many other realizations of these physical realizations that happen to satisfy this property. For instance, another one is like you take light, and you take a single photon of light, okay, which is light, I mean, like the quantum of light. You can prepare in a given polarization, and you can make a polarization measurement, and you will see that the light goes either in one detector or another detector.
So in this setup where you've prepared an electron and measured it, is the probability of half a subject of the perfect orthogonal alignment of the preparation and the measurement, or is it off by, you know, if your machine's a degree off, are you going to see it?
Yes. Okay, so these are...
So it's half to as accurate as you can prepare your equipment.
Exactly. This is a very good question. Very good, very good. This is a very good question, and I will use this. Of course, this, what to do that, okay, I have to make sure that my machine is doing this. Because it could be that I think that my field is aligned in the z-direction, but actually it's a bit misaligned. So what is happening is that this is not 1, 0, but it's another basis element, which is cos theta, sin theta, where theta is very close to 0. And this will be minus, well, now let me see, how should I do this, cos? Right, now I think, no, yes, of course. Yes? Now they are orthogonal, okay? Where this theta is very close to 0, so I believe that it's pointing in the z direction, but actually this angle can be related to the direction of the B field, which means that this won't be 1/2. Yes, I will mention this, okay? But what the theory tells you is that if you are sure about your preparation and about the measurement you implement, it's not ignorance, okay? You have the best possible preparation in your theory, and the best possible measurement. It's not because it's noisy. It's just because the theory tells you the predictions with probabilities. Okay, I understand that you may not like this. I didn't like it when I was a student, okay? I never liked quantum physics. No one likes quantum physics, okay? Because, no, I mean, you know, there is a famous quote by Richard Feynman who said, I can safely say that nobody understands quantum physics. So Richard Feynman is a Nobel, he won the Nobel Prize, okay? He was one of the best physicists we had last century. So even Richard Feynman didn't like quantum, well, didn't like or didn't understand. So no one understands quantum physics. So it's counterintuitive. And precisely this sort of reasoning, for instance, Einstein also disliked a lot quantum physics. And there is this famous quote like, he does not play dice, no? God does not play dice, because he didn't like the random character of quantum physics. So this is another valid option. You may say, I don't like quantum physics, so I don't want to buy any device based on quantum physics. Which is, again, it's a matter of taste, OK? But if you like quantum, and you accept quantum physics, and I can tell you that quantum physics is passes any experimental test in any lab every day, then this is the truth about how atoms behave at the moment. And this is correct for these physical devices. Okay? So the question is, we want to use this source of randomness. And again, if you go to a book on classical physics, you will never find anything like this. Everything is deterministic. Of course, if things are noisy or you don't have preparation, you don't know. But here in quantum physics, I'm not saying that something is noisy. I'm just saying that you are really preparing the state of the spin pointing in the x direction, and you are really measuring the z direction. And this is what the theory can tell you about, no more than this. OK.
The theory is noisy.
Huh?
The theory is noisy.
Yeah, you can think like the theory contains some sort of intrinsic noise or intrinsic randomness that is not associated to ignorance of your theory. So within the theory, the best you can say is to make a prediction in probabilistic terms. So for instance, what Einstein thought at that time was that that was showing that quantum theory is some sort of effective theory. That effective theory. So there might be another theory that goes beyond quantum physics where this randomness disappears. So how randomness disappears in our classical world? Well, we always say, OK, this is random because I don't know all the variables that are in play. If I had knowledge about these variables, then I could make a deterministic prediction. OK, maybe this is in from an informative point of view, I need a supercomputer for that. But in principle, if I have this knowledge, I can make a deterministic prediction. So Einstein thought that in quantum physics, the problem is that there is another theory with another variables that we don't know today. And once we know this theory and we know this, what he called hidden variables, then all the randomness of quantum physics disappears because we will be able to make deterministic predictions. Okay. Okay. So this is what the theory tells you. So for instance, what you can do, and this is some of the what idée quantique does. Okay. So what you can do, for instance, based on these analogies, you can try to implement this sort of quantum coin in the lab. Okay. So a possible way of doing it is like you take a. Okay. This is I'm a theorist. Okay. But a possible way of doing it is like you take light and you prepare single photons of light. Okay. This single quantum of light. We can do this. Okay. And you send this light into a mirror that has transmittivity equal to 1/2. And you put here a detector. Okay? So you send the photon, and the mirror has transmittivity 1/2. I'm assuming that I can do all these things perfectly. Yeah, right? So you have this mirror that is perfectly has transmittivity 1/2, and then quantum physics tells you, well, the photon can be either transmitted or reflected with probability 1/2. So you have this quantum coin. And this is because it's based on quantum physics. Okay? And then the company, IDE Quantique, they make products based on these principles. Okay? So now if I go to the slides. Hello? Okay. It's coming. Okay, so these are the slides that Grégoire sent me. He would have never given this talk. Don't tell him, please. But he's a good friend, so he will forgive me. Okay, so you see here in the picture, they are doing what I was telling you, okay? So, I mean, this is another way of seeing, okay? So there is this source of light, and they prepare photons, okay? A light bulb is not a source of single photons, okay? But it's just a pictorial way of representing this. So there are ways of preparing single photons. And then they send it into this mirror, and you see they detect either here or here, and this, they record where the photon goes, and this is the way they generate random bits. Okay, he writes truly random. We will come back to that later. Okay, so the thing is that, speed, I'm not sure, speed is good, but of course, I mean, say, pseudo-random number generators based on software are much faster than this technology, okay? But, okay, they achieve good speeds because this is, from a technological point of view, this is not so difficult, okay? And actually, I think what I do, basically, I don't know the details, but basically what I record is how a LED that it emits light, whether it goes to this detector or this detector. This is what the way they generate the random numbers. Okay, and well, they can miniaturize and they can make products out of this, okay? So it's highly reliable, I'm sorry, but okay, they can make products based on this, basically this idea, okay? So here you have the quantities, and this is the speed that you can get, and of course the applications, you know better than me what you can use them for, okay? And of course what they had also was something nice is that they have an interaction with Matthias Troyer, who is a physicist working in Zurich, who is a guy who is very powerful, has very powerful computational skills. So they made some tests to test the autocorrelation and make statistical tests over the generated random numbers. And actually, they implement some extraction processes to distill the randomness to the output. Okay. So they have some reduction because this extraction. Well, I think you also know about randomness extraction. Okay, you just implement. You know more than me, I'm sure, about it. They got patents for that. And lately, what they are also considering, and I think this was based on a paper that was published by the group of Nicolas Gisin in Geneva. So they are exploring other schemes where what you do, you shine light on a camera, okay, and you record where the light goes. Okay. And the nice thing about this, I think it was even mentioned in the paper, is that you may think of using a mobile phone, okay, for that. Okay. But for that, he's the right guy to to ask questions about these technological solutions. Okay, but all these are technological solutions that are based on light at the quantum level, and because we think that light at the quantum level is described by Hilbert spaces and by quantum physics, and quantum physics, the equations, you have probability in the equations. Okay, and this is why you believe it's random. And a way of then going to this regime is putting the waveguide to guide the light from the LED to the to this screen that is detecting where the photons are collected. And then you apply an extractor and some classical post-processing on the data to distill the randomness, that, the quantum randomness that is there. OK, so this is all what I'm going to say about ID-quantic, OK, so about technology. I'm going to focus more on randomness. And so since I'm a theorist and I work on randomness, I will tell you what I think is the right way to go and to use quantum randomness. And this is something that is may happen in the future, and which is a novel approach to quantum random number generators, which is related to some of the points that we're mentioning here. Okay. So remember, one of the remarks you had was, how do I, what happens if this direction of the magnetic field, for instance, I was telling you, is not the one I thought. Okay, it was not 1001, but it has an angle, which you can never exclude. Okay, you, in the end, it seems that you are basing the my random properties are based on my perfect knowledge about the initial the conditions of my experiment. And the second one was related to this comment by Einstein, no, whether there exists a theory that goes beyond quantum physics, and if I had knowledge in this theory, I could make probabilistic predictions deterministic. Okay, so now I will tell you my view as an say sort of outsider, what are the problems with solutions for random number generation. So the first thing, the first remark I want to do is that, in a way, I mean, of course, as a quantum physicist, I like the solutions of quantum randomness based on photons going into a beam, into a mirror and things like this. But if you think about it, I mean, it's just one more physical random number generator. Okay, okay. In one case, you base this random number generator in meteorology. In another case, you base in quantum physics. I prefer the ones that are based on quantum physics, but it's similar to a physical random number generator, okay? And I see several problems with all these solutions, including also the software ones, okay? So the first problem is certification. So what do ID-quantic and other companies that sell quantum random number generators do, okay? They give you a device, and they tell you, this is a quantum random number generator. And you say, ah, very good, thank you. And they say, how do you know that it's random? They say, we pass all statistical tests that exist today. Okay? Well, I think from a quantum physics, this is very unsatisfactory. Okay? Well, why? Because we have classical systems that pass all statistical tests. So you are not telling me that you're, it's hard. So if I want to believe that this solution is quantum, I have to trust the provider. So I have to go to ID-quantic, and then they give me a box, and they say, this is quantum. And you say, oh, really, why? And they tell you, because I tell you, okay? So this is all what you can do. Then you go back to your lab and you run the statistical test and they pass them, but we know that classical solutions also pass the statistical test. So I don't have any way of certifying that something is say quantum random. As a user. Of course the provider, if I trust them, they tried their best and they were using single photons, they were using quantum effects. But me as a user, I only get a box where it's written quantum random number generator. OK, but I don't have means of certifying that something is quantum, first thing. Then even, frankly speaking to me, when I see these tests, OK, they are nice, but do we really understand what they mean? I mean, when I don't know, perhaps you can tell me. OK, to me, having a device that passes this statistical test, I'm not sure how much it tells about the random properties of the. Of course, it means that some patterns are not there. OK, and of course, now the example I like for that, possibly you know this, Randu. Do you know about this random number generator? This you can find in Wikipedia. OK, this was a random number generator that was used in the 60s, and it was random. OK? But then, I don't know, there was a day where someone had the idea of taking three numbers of produced by this random number generator and plot them in the x, y, z plane. And then he found this pattern. Of course, this is not random, OK? Because there cannot be such a pattern in a proper random number generator. So what this means is that before this guy had this idea, these numbers were not random. And the day after this guy had this idea, they were not random anymore. Well, this is insane. Come on, it doesn't make any sense. Okay, so this is why statistical tests, frankly speaking, well, I don't buy them for randomness. Okay, if you don't pass them, then this is a problem. But if you pass them, I'm not very happy with this. So I think we need ways of certifying randomness. And in the case of quantum solutions, it's even worse, okay? Because we certify randomness with tools that are satisfied by classical solutions. Okay, the second thing is privacy. Okay, for that, I will illustrate this with some sort of academic situation, but it's important, which is what I call the memory stick attack. Okay, so imagine you are convinced after my lecture that quantumness is something super good for random number generation, and you want to make business out of this, okay? So you say, okay, I know what this is my business plan. I will make a virtual casino. This is cheap, I only need to make a web page. I only need a good random number generator, but I want to make it really random. And I know this guy told me about quantum, so I will do it with a quantum random number generator, okay? So you come to me. Then I know that you want these random numbers for your virtual casino. So what I do before you come, and I have quantum stuff, so I take these single photons, I send them into the mirror, I detect the clicks, I generate these random numbers. But then what I do, I copy these random numbers into a memory, okay? Huge memory. I know what's your computer power, okay? So I take a huge memory, and then I put this memory into a box. I paint it in fancy colors. I write quantum random number generator. I charge you twice because it's quantum. So you take this box and you say, well, you know, this guy, I mean, I'm not sure if he was fully reliable. So, you know, I'm Catalan, and usually Catalans, we have the reputation that we like money a lot, okay? So you know that I'm Catalan, so you say, okay, I better check if the guy is trying to cheat me or not. So you generate the random numbers and you check with this test. And of course, these numbers that are produced by the device will pass any test, because let's say I use quantum physics to generate them. So you say, oh, okay, good. So you use the random numbers, and I wait for this moment, and I take all your money. Okay, why? Because, again, I am assuming that my memory is large enough so that I pass your test. I am assuming that I have some knowledge about your computational power. Why? Because the numbers are random to you, but they are not random to me, because I generated them in advance. This is why, if you remember my definition of randomness, I demand unpredictability to anyone. This is an academic situation, but if you go to a decantic of any company, what they sell you is a box, okay? And you can, unless you open the box, you can never exclude that there is this memory stick producing these random numbers. Even if you open the box, you will see a laser and a detector. It might be that the laser sends light, the detector forgets about this light and produces an output that was recorded, okay? So you can open the detector and maybe you see there, but even if, you know, it's like, okay, there is a lot of things that might go. Okay, I understand this is a bit paranoid, because here you are thinking that you are buying your random number generator from the enemy, okay? But again, what this is telling you is that you need to put trust on your provider. And trust for cryptography is a delicate issue. And the last thing is related to the comment that was mentioned before. The properties of these random numbers depend a lot on the physics of my devices. I like a lot physical security, but this is also a weakness. Because at the very end, whether my device is good or not will depend on whether I can prepare a mirror with transmittivity 50%, okay? If I don't prepare a mirror with transmittivity 50%, then these numbers won't be as random as I thought. So again, you have to put a lot of trust on your provider, that your provider has really prepared this mirror with this 50% transmittivity. And again, it can be that the provider is a nice person, is not the enemy, as in the memory stick attack, but maybe his knowledge about what's going on in the device is not perfect. Well, for sure it's not perfect. Okay, there might be many ways in which the devices behave in a different way as you model them. And if your enemy buys these devices and it has a better knowledge about how these devices behave, maybe he can predict better this. Okay, so imagine you think that it's 50%, the enemy buys and sees that in the mirrors that were used by the company, actually there is a small deviation. Then this enemy will have a better modeling of the devices and will have a better knowledge of the randoms that were apparently random. So this is the property that I call device dependent. So things depend a lot on the physics of your devices. This is a weakness. Physical security is very nice, but when you depend a lot on physics, this is a problem. And as you say here, I was saying many things about trust, okay? So you go to the provider, you trust that he has prepared a quantum solution, that he has put a mirror of 50% transmittivity, and so on and so on, okay? And this may seem paranoid that the provider has made some mistakes or even is your enemy, but perhaps you are aware that there were these a Snowden affair, and some of the documents revealed that some devices that were used and even approved by NIST were not secure. Okay, so NSA was pushing NIST to use some devices, knowing that they could hack them. Okay, so there is an issue there with certification that is not only quantum physics. I mean, cryptography is cares about certification. Okay, so just to summarize what I have said until now, okay? So what I told you is that I gave you a definition of randomness, which is unpredictable to anyone, not only the user that has access to the device, but to everyone who can be there. Then I told you that within this definition, there is a paradigm of physical computational security, but I didn't discuss anything about this because I'm not an expert. And then I told you about physical security. So in physical security, the user that has the device and every possible person that is outside that might be correlated with this device, the actions of all the people in the game are limited and are described by a physical theory. In this case, quantum physics. Then I told you, like, classical physics is not good for randomness, that in quantum physics we have a source of randomness which is given by the postulates of the theory. So I told you that based on these postulates you can make devices, there are companies that sell these devices, and then I told you that I see some problems with the devices, which are you depend a lot on the properties of your devices. You cannot guarantee that the numbers are private, that could not have been generated before you. And also the certification is based on these statistical tests that I don't really like. Okay. So now let's try to see what we can do with quantum physics and if we can solve any of these problems. So what I will tell you about is that if you have the previous situation where you have this observer or user, then you cannot solve any of these situations. Okay. Again, the only thing you can hope for is what we already have. Okay. So we can only make randomness if we specify what is happening inside the box. Like the box, there is a single photon and a mirror with transmitted one half and things like this. So you cannot solve these problems with a single box. And this is because from an outside perspective, a box that produces output, you can describe with classical physics and quantum physics. Only if I say, no, I know that this box is quantum, and actually I know that this box is producing photons and that these photons are going to a mirror and so on and so on. Only if I make modelings and hypotheses about my box, I can certify that something is random. But from the outside, I can never do anything like this.
What do you mean? The first problem, or the third, I guess, the mirror is biased, like it's not perfect, and you would notice it from the outside.
Yes, okay, but there might be things like, I don't know, maybe might be the detectors have some memory effects, say, okay? And there are some patterns that I only see when of course, bias is something very easy to notice, no? But let's assume that the detectors, when they click, maybe it takes some time for click again, so it's more likely that the other click. But there might be memory effects that introduce some patterns in your signal, and these patterns are not checked by the statistical test. Okay, so this is, there are many things that can happen, and that you never see from just the outside. Okay, so I will move to two systems. Okay, so actually my lecture is going now to be about physics, but you will see why I make this theory about physics, because we'll solve some of the issues that you mentioned. So what I will use is something that we have in quantum physics, that is the fact that correlations between devices, quantum devices, I can get correlations that I cannot describe with classical physics. Okay, so I'm not going to tell you how, but I can tell you that, actually I will tell you a bit about this, that there are some. If now I don't care, I don't only have one device, but I have two devices, me as a user. You see the red box is the user. So then you can get some effects that are possible within quantum physics and that are not possible in classical physics. Okay, so this is my new scenario. Me, I'm the user. Before I had one box, now we'll have two boxes in my secure location, and there will be an enemy there. And I will check here what are the correlations between these boxes. What's the probability that I see? I can tell you more about this, but I don't have time to enter about these details. Okay, so it will be more qualitative explanation. And why I know that things are not possible in quantum physics and classical physics? Because there is something called Bell inequalities. So this is what I'm going to tell you about. I'm going to give you a crash course on Bell inequalities that I will use for randomness. This is the most amazing thing in quantum physics. So you won't understand what I'm saying because nobody understands. Okay? I mean, you will understand the math because it's super simple. But I mean, intuitively, I don't really understand what's going on here. And this is what Einstein didn't like. Okay, this is precisely the point that Einstein disliked about quantum physics. So it's a very simple situation. Okay, so let's imagine now, let's forget about quantum physics. Let's just think about what can happen in nature. Let's imagine the following experiment. So, I don't know, I have a source, okay, or someone has a source, and this source prepares particles, pairs of particles, one here and one there. And these particles are sent to another person who makes a measurement, another person who makes a measurement. So we can even think of the following, okay? I take two people in the audience, and I send one person to a room and the other person to a different room, okay? Where they cannot communicate. We can make this experiment, right? We don't need quantum particles for that. Okay, so this source, it's me who sends these two people to different rooms, okay? I take Jean-Paul, I send it upstairs, and I take you, for instance, you are here. Okay, good. Now, when they are upstairs, I'm going to ask two questions, okay? They're going to say one and two. So these two questions, you can think of whatever. I mean, do you want color red or green? Okay, they're just, I can ask two questions, okay? So for instance, I can leave in the room, I can put a shirt and some trousers that can be red or green, okay? So my question is shirt or trouser, and the choice by the person who is in the room is red or green. So when Jean-Paul goes there, I tell him, okay, take the shirt that you want, okay? And he can take the red or the green, okay? Or sometimes I can say, maybe not trousers, take some, I don't know, hat, okay? It can be red and green. He chooses what he wants to do once in the room. I will label this choice of my question by one and two. So one can be for trouser and or hat, and two for a shirt. And his choice of color plus one and minus one. These are convention, but I can always do that. Okay, so what I do, I keep these people in these rooms, and I keep making them, forcing them to make choices. Okay, sometimes they say plus one, sometimes minus one, as they want. I mean, and I even allow them to, before they are sent to the rooms, to agree on a strategy. So they can say, okay, if they ask me about question one, I will say plus one. If they ask me about question minus one, I will say, or question two, I will say minus one. They can even write a piece of paper if they don't have good memory, just saying what they are going to behave. Is the game clear? It's super simple, okay? So I send them to these rooms, and I keep asking questions, and they keep telling me plus one, minus one, as they wish, okay, as they agreed in advance. So what I will do at the end, I play this many times, I compute this expression here. So A1 is what Jean-Paul told me when I asked question one. And A2 is what he told me when I asked question two. It can be plus one or minus one. And B1 and B2 is the same for the other person who stayed here. Okay? Super simple. It's just plus and minus ones. Okay. So in classical physics, these are just measurements, okay? I have this particle, and I interrogate this particle. Now it's a person, but it can be a particle. I say, okay, I measure this quantity, tell me what's the result, plus one and minus one. So these values A1 and A2 can be plus and minus one. This is the only possibility. Well, if you put plus and minus ones here, I can tell you the only values you can get are plus and minus two. There are many ways of proving this. The simplest one is to put all possible assignments. So for instance, let's assume that all of them are one. This is plus one, plus one, plus one, and this is minus one. It gives plus two. Okay? Good. So if I repeat the experiment, it may be that this varies from two, plus two to minus two, but on average, it will never go beyond two, because at most can be two. So if I repeat the experiment, on average, it will be at most two. Okay, I guess everyone follows what I'm saying. Okay, super trivial mathematics. This, again, I can do with two people from the audience. I can give with two particles where I will make this measurement and get these outputs. Okay, now you go to quantum physics. And what you do, you prepare one of these spin 1/2 particles. You send them here. You make some measurements. I can forget about this. What I'm telling you is that there's a state of quantum particles where you can make some measurements. You make this experiment. You ask these questions, sometimes one, sometimes two. You get plus one and minus one. And you get a value which is 2 squared root of 2, that is larger than 2. So how come quantum physics manages to do that? I don't know. but it happens. Okay, so there are experiments where you can make this. What this means, okay, is that before these guys are sent to the rooms, what they can do, they can prepare this state of the particles. Jean-Paul can take one of the particles. You can take the other particle. You can go to this room with the particle. They get my question. Depending on my question, they make a measurement. And depending on the result of the measurement, they choose one of the colors. They can do this. Okay? And you will see that the value of this expression then will be 2 squared of 2. It won't be 2. Okay, so if you are not surprised by this, so you must be surprised, because this I don't understand. Okay? And this is what Einstein didn't like. And this is where it was proven that Einstein was wrong. Okay? So there is something wrong, but of course, it's not the mathematics. The mathematics is super simple. It's just plus and minus ones. Okay? So what is failing here? Why things are not correct? Well, the only assumption I made is that these values for question 1 and question 2 were predetermined in a deterministic way. And since I violate this, it means that this assumption cannot be correct. So these values are not predetermined. So they are random. Okay? And just follows from the fact that you violate this expression. And this expression, you see, I can compute from the outside. I don't need to make any modeling of my devices. I just, you want press buttons and recording outputs. And I see if this condition is violated. And if it is, then I know that what is inside is quantum, because with classical physics, I can never have a value larger than 2. And on top of that, I know that these values were not predetermined, so they are random. Okay, so our proposal, and not only ours, but some other people, what we think is that the right way of using quantum physics to generate randomness, or the most advanced way of using quantum physics to generate randomness, is to do it in this way. Because you certify your randomness with a test that is not satisfied by classical devices. With classical devices, I can never go beyond 2. And you can certify that things are random. Just to summarize, this is sometimes called the violation of these quantities here is sometimes called non-locality. Okay, these are sometimes they are called Bell inequalities. So what happens is if you have done some devices that violate this Bell inequality, you know that things are random. And moreover, this is something that is impossible with classical physics, because in classical physics, quantities are assigned from the very beginning. So the only value you can get is 2. So you know that also the devices are quantum. So here's the solution we propose for that. So if you go to the provider, remember the memory stick, you have this virtual casino. You don't ask me one box to generate randomness. You ask me 2 boxes, and you check whether you violate one of these conditions. If you do, you know for sure that what I prepare is quantum, because there is no way of doing this with classical physics. And you can also certify, and I will very briefly tell you how, that things are random. And as I said, the good thing about this is I don't have to make any modeling or believe. I mean, the provider will have to do things so that they violate this condition. But me,
I'm just saying that here you're certifying that the randomness is coming from a
quantum device.
Source,
yes.
Not the point, right?
So if you want, another way of seeing this is that if someone gives me a box, I don't know whether the randomness I see is because the guy did the right things in the device, or maybe it was something noisy. Here, this randomness can only come from a quantum origin. Okay? And the reason why we can do that is because we have techniques within quantum physics, but for that you need a bit of machinery, where from this Bell violation, remember, I was telling you that what you expect is to get a value equal to 2, but you can go up to 2 squared of 2. From this, we can bound the amount of randomness in the output. Okay, so you see, the curve is, okay, it has a this form, but it's quite natural, okay? Because at the point where you get 2, this is classical physics. I can always do with you staying here and you going upstairs, I can always get 2. Of course, I cannot certify any randomness. I get 0 bits. But as soon as I enter the region where I violate, I start having some randomness. I can certify some randomness. And actually, at the point of maximal quantum violation, this 2 squared of 2 I was telling you about, I get 1 random bit. And the only reason why I can know that this is random is because, again, I assume quantum physics. Okay, I assume the validity of quantum physics. I know that this region here is just impossible with quantum physics. Okay, so if my provider is a quantum person that cannot violate quantum physics, it's impossible that the provider even if he was my enemy, it's impossible that my provider has prepared some boxes that give this amount of violation and where the random is zero, where he has fixed everything. Because if he has fixed everything in the box, the most I can see is 2, as I just proved you. So if I see val larger than 2, he hasn't fixed everything, so there is some randomness, and we can even bound the amount of randomness. So in this proposal, you forget about statistical tests or anything like this. So you get these 2 boxes, you compute this Bell, what is called this Bell violation, which is just a number, and then you take this curve, and from this curve, you have this amount of randomness measured by entropy, and then you apply some randomness extractor to the solution. Okay, this is, in my opinion, the right way to go, but it's more demanding. Okay, so you need to, okay, with the boxes, it's easy to see, okay, but now wait. But you have to make this experiment, okay? You have to make this with a commercial product. This is not so easy. It's possible, but it's not so easy. So for instance, we collaborated with an experimental group. What they did in this experimental group, they prepared 2 atoms. So they had 2 atoms in these 2 boxes. And they had these 2 atoms in 2 what is called separate traps. So they trapped the atoms in 2 places. And they were making these measurements here and asking the results, OK? And then they were giving us, they were in the States. They were making the experiment. At the end of the day, they were giving us a number here. And they were able to tell them, OK, you generated some output that had this amount of entropy. They didn't make the extraction. Okay, but we could tell them that because they observe a point here, we could certify that they had this amount of randomness, assuming that everything was going on was quantum physics. So they didn't have to send us the details of the devices. What was the frequency of the atom trap or what was, no. They only had to send us the amount of the expression for this observable. OK? They didn't have to specify anything about what they were doing. Of course, they have to care about the details. But, so they can, you can think of them as the provider. But us, as a user, we only needed to get this value of this number. I hope it's more or less clear what I'm saying. It's a bit tough for you because. OK, and again, I think this is the right way to go. And some people are adopting this. And I think it might be adopted if technology advances. So for instance, if you go to NIST, so this is the National Institute of Standard Technologies, they care about randomness generation. They want to produce good randomness and certify that this is good randomness. And they have something that is called the randomness beacon, where they generate random randomness, public randomness that you can use. Okay? So for instance, if you, I don't know, hopefully it's not going to happen to you, but if you get married and you get divorced and you want to see who keeps the dog, then you can do it with something that will be generated by NIST tomorrow. You trust them. Okay? This will be random. So they are having this source of public randomness. And what they use at the moment is just solutions that you are more familiar with. So they don't use any quantum solution. But they are really, what they said, I mean, you go to the web page in this randomness beacon, what they tell you is that unpredictable values are not possible in any classical physical context. This is what I was telling you. Okay? And what they want to do is to use quantum effects to generate a sequence of truly random values. Okay, and when they tell, okay, this is what they are exploring. At the moment, they are not doing this way, but they have a project to explore, to incorporate truly quantum effects to generate truly random numbers. And when you see what they do, they have these 2 particles and this Bell test I was telling you about. Okay, so this is, it's within reach for some people. It cannot happen that now you will get a chip based on these ideas, but. People are seriously considering this option because, again, in the context of physical security, it has some nice advantages. The certification is purely quantum. You don't care about, it's device independent. You don't have to care about how you align things as a user. You simply see if this number is above 2, it's random. And with this, I'm about to conclude. So I said many things. I used to say many things in my talks. So here are the take-home messages. Sometimes, something that I don't like, and I think we also learn in quantum information theory, sometimes people see it as a fight between quantum information theory and classical information theory. I think this is not the right way to go. So I think quantum information theory for cryptography offers you a different range of solutions. You don't have computational security, you have physical security. If you like it, you go for it. If not, you stay with computational security. me as a physicist, I prefer physical security also because I can work with this. Okay, but it's just different. Okay, it's just physical security. So the assumptions are different. So I don't think there is anything better or worse. I mean, there are solutions based on assumption. In this case, the assumption is whatever the devices are on Earth, they are described by quantum physics. And the protocol is secure because if it's not secure, it means that someone is doing stuff against quantum physics. So then I told you about devices that can be based on quantum effects. So the first thing I was telling you is about this idea here of the photons going into the mirror. Okay? So there, what you use is this description of quantum physics in terms of probabilities that you can find in any textbook. Okay? So you don't need any good knowledge of quantum physics after university. You take the first pages of any textbook in quantum physics, you understand what's going on and what you need for quantum random number generators. And this is what commercial solutions for quantum random generators use. And then I spend more time on my stuff, which is this new approach to, I'm sorry for that, this new approach for random generation, which is based on this correlation between these two devices. Why? Because it's only when you study correlation between the two devices where quantum physics really differs from classical physics. It's only there where you show that Einstein was wrong. So this Bell inequality, now I come back to what you were asking, prove that the dream of Einstein of finding a theory that is complete and where the determinism is restored is not possible. Okay, so this is, if you have followed this Bell inequality reasoning, this is what it proves. Okay?
So the follow-up question.
Okay. I will go. Okay, let me just. I conclude and I come back to the question. Okay? Yeah, because I was. Well, this is a new solution that is being explored. Will be adopted by NIST, and this is important. It's much more demanding than what is now in the market. Okay? So this is why, principal NIST and some labs are doing these things. Okay? And now I will go back to your. So there is nothing wrong. Okay? What is wrong is my. I mean, it's just. I mean, quantum physics doesn't violate any information theory. We use information theory for that, okay? So what is wrong is precisely this assumption, okay? So if you see here, so you can think of the following, okay? So usually the way we used to think about correlations is like, they know they are going to be asked about question one and two. So the way we think is that they wrote in a piece of paper what the answers are going to be. So these things were written in advance, predetermined, okay? And they go. So this is what is not true in the experiment. You can think that it's not true, okay? Because in the experiment, you cannot ask the two questions at the same time. In quantum physics, you cannot measure, say, spin in the z and x direction at the same time. So I will ask Jean-Paul, I will tell him, take a hat or a shirt, but I will never ask the two, okay? But they might be asked about the two. They might be asked about the two. They don't know about this. So the only way we know is that, in this case, is that since you are going to be asked about the two, you have to write the two in the piece of paper when you go. Okay? But somehow in quantum physics, and this is what we don't understand, somehow the particle gives this, I mean, it's like the answer, okay, I don't know how to convey this idea because it's not intuitive, okay? But produces the output when you ask it. Okay? It's not written in the particle, but somehow it's produced at the moment. But you cannot ask the two questions to the quantum particle. Huh? Ah, but the possibility that I can do one thing or the other, yes. So this is.
So you're adding a two conditional probabilities where the condition on the question.
Yes. So it's not. I'm not. So all the language that we use is standard information theory, but dealing with conditional probabilities. Very good. But we never have. So it doesn't exist a joint probability distribution for A1 and A2. It does not exist. But you never have access to this object in the experiment because you never ask A1 or A2. You ask either about A1, which is the probability of the output given that input was 1, or A2, which is the probability of the output given that input was 2. But the input is never 1 and 2 at the same time, and this is why there is nothing like this. So it's just standard information theory. Okay. Now, perhaps if I can say something, this is a solution. Now, if you like this sort of metaphysical, philosophical discussions, a la Einstein, let's say, let me just spend a bit of time. Of course, the reason why this works is because when they go to the rooms, they know that they might be asked about any of the two answers, but they don't know which one. So this means that they cannot predict which question they are going to get. So the question they are going to get is random to them. So there is some circularity in the argument. Because I need to assume somehow that my choice of the question is random. Okay? So from a fundamental perspective, this is as close as we can to prove that things are random. But of course, we need to assume that they don't know which question are going to be asked. Because if they know the question they are going to be asked, then they can say, oh, I know I'm going to be asked about one, so I write the solution. Well, maybe I'm going a bit too far, okay? Just say that it's important the fact that they don't know which question they are going to be asked in the room.
If you're saying that if you sell these two machines to someone and this decides they always press one, then there's a...
Yeah, of course. The machine will always work because the provider will give me these two boxes with two buttons, and he doesn't know in advance which button I'm going to press. Because if he knew, then he could simply write the instructions, okay? But nothing... I think this is, has to be clear. I mean, quantum physics is weird, but it doesn't change mathematics or information theory. Okay, this is same level. I only deal with conditional probability distributions.
So, if I want to test the box from the provider, then I cannot just take two boxes and see what the boxes that can be 0 or 1, the provider has to enable me such an option to test them, right?
Mm-hmm. Or plus or minus one, let's say, with my convention, yes?
Minus one, then if I have two boxes with plus one, minus one, then can I do this test?
No, I need to have this choice between one and two, yes. Because if I don't have any choice, what the provider can do, it can generate the experiment in advance, copy everything into the boxes, and this is what is produced. So it's precisely by the fact that the provider doesn't know what I'm going to do, that he cannot write this. Because if he had written these things, then this value will be bounded by 2. And as I see that this value is larger than 2, he cannot have written these things in the boxes. Also because he doesn't know about what I'm going to do, okay? So don't expect to understand. I hope that you understand the logic of the argument, but don't think, it's very intuitive, because it's not. Yes.
I'm not randomized my question, so I can expect the probabilities to be have a different distribution. So,
yes. So,
so it's necessary for me to randomize my questioning in order to be able to show the Bell inequality.
So what is necessary for you is that, if you want, that your choice is not known by the person who prepared the source. Whether you call it this random. I mean, you can make it, if you give me the boxes.
So, but if I always took the left option,
No, sure. Yeah, of course. No, no.
We didn't know it could do that. So it's necessary for the questioner to do some randomization in order to for the things to add up to greater than.
Yes. So what you need first in the experiment, you need to compute these four numbers. Okay? So if you have to compute these four numbers, it means that sometimes you have to press button one and sometimes you have to press button two. Otherwise you cannot compute this. First thing. Okay? Now, as I said, if you know in advance how you are going to choose between these two numbers, then I can, since you know that it's not, I don't have to write instruction for the two possibilities, I only have to write for the one you are going to press at that given moment in time, then I can do everything, okay? So what I have to assume is that somehow the provider has no access to what my choice is going to be in advance. Again, it's an assumption. Again, if you don't like this assumption, don't buy this solution. Okay, so this is what I wanted to say. I think it's not worse and bad. I think it's good to state the assumptions, and with this, you prove the security or randomness of a solution. Yes.
Okay. Thank you.